Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Off the Mark, How Grades, Ratings, and Rankings Undermine Learning, but Don't Have to, by Jack Schneider and Ethan L. Hutt. Narrated by Rudy, Sanda. Introduction. We began work on this book before the COVID-19 outbreak swept across the globe. And as the pandemic shuttered schools, colleges, and universities, we wondered whether our project might suddenly be irrelevant amid such a massive disruption. In the early days, it seemed possible. Soon, however, we realized that grades, ratings, and rankings were more pertinent than ever. With students learning from home, would their work be graded? Some young people had robust networks of support, while others were on their own. Many lacked adequate internet connections. Given these disparities, could grading be done fairly? And would it actually measure learning? Or would it simply correlate with the extent to which students' lives had been turned upside down? Assigning students grades wasn't the only evaluation practice disrupted by the pandemic. Each year, students across every level of schooling take millions of standardized tests. A cornerstone of nearly all these tests is that they are administered under the same conditions and, often, at exactly the same time. But the pandemic made assembling any number of students in one place for an hours-long examination not just unfeasible, but unethical. Even so, the literal life and death stakes of the pandemic couldn't stop families and educators around the country from worrying about what the disruption in testing would mean for students. What would happen to young people enrolled in advanced placement courses? Could students take their exams from home? Would colleges still award them credit for their scores? What about students about to apply to college? Would the SAT and ACT tests still be given? Would colleges and universities still require them for admission? And what about state-mandated standardized tests? Would they be administered? Those were just the questions of most immediate concern. Longer-term questions lingered, too. How would the disrupted learning of the pandemic school years be memorialized for future audiences on students' transcripts? Would courses that students could not complete still appear there? Should students' grades be accompanied by asterisks or perhaps converted to pass-fail? If schools adopted these policies, would students be given a choice about the form of their grade, or should schools unilaterally apply the new policies? Equity seemed to demand across-the-board solutions. But what about the students who had gone into the pandemic with A averages, which they had so assiduously maintained? Was it fair to wipe that away? Faced with the possibility of their grades being converted to pass-fail, students at Harvard countered that any deviation in policy should stay in line with existing norms. Instead of pass-fail, the students argued that Harvard should adopt a double-A system that included two grades, an A and an A-. This counterproposal only raised still more fundamental questions. Was a school's responsibility to protect the interests of its students? To ensure the general integrity of its grading system? To safeguard the fairness of the larger system of higher education? The debates over these and related questions were fierce, and emotions ran hot. Parents started online petitions, advocacy groups filed lawsuits, and newspapers printed countless op-eds. Even the New York Times ethicist felt compelled to weigh in on the equities at stake in these questions. One thing was clear. Problems with assessment definitely weren't going away. Although it took a worldwide crisis to place these questions at the forefront of our discussion about education, the challenges they highlighted were with us all along. Consider some of the language we have for describing the problems and predicaments associated with educational assessment. How often have we heard complaints about teachers teaching to the test and students cramming for their exams, knowing full well that learning is beside the point? How often have students shrewdly identified the gut classes offering an easy A, or fallen back on strategies like grade-grubbing or grade-lawyering for higher marks? Virtually everyone who has been to school is aware that any reference to one's permanent record is to be taken as a thinly veiled threat. This enduring displeasure with what we call assessment technologies, the most notable of which are grades, tests, and transcripts, has fueled a cottage industry of critique. Scholars and self-proclaimed thought leaders have thoroughly documented shortcomings in the way schools measure and record student learning. Still more have offered prepackaged solutions to the problems associated with grading, rating, and ranking. Yet, despite more than a century of critique, they have, by and large, failed to alter the dominant approach to measuring student learning. Why is that? The first reason is that our assessment practices are deeply intertwined with each other, with our educational institutions, and with other parts of society. This deep entanglement underlies virtually all of the questions raised by the pandemic. An altered grade or a missing test score during one year, families feared, would continue to reverberate well into the future. Likewise, the choices made by a single college or university could have rippling consequences across higher education and down through K-12 schools. But there is another sense in which our assessment technologies are intertwined and, therefore, extremely resistant to change and prone to dysfunction. This is easily illustrated with an example that will be familiar to anyone who has issued or received a grade. Imagine that a teacher gives a student a C to communicate something along the lines of, "Hey, this isn't your best work." The teacher knows that his pupil is bright and capable, and he wants to challenge her to rise to her potential. Yet the student receiving the C is mostly attuned to anything but what her teacher thinks he's saying. She knows that her parents will see that grade. And more importantly, she knows that college admissions officers and employers might someday look at her transcript. She's focused on keeping that permanent record blemish-free. Instead of hearing a gentle chiding, then, the student is likely hearing something more along the lines of, "Watch out, because I can ruin your future." She might apply herself more diligently, but not in the way her teacher imagined, and not without some serious unintended consequences. Despite these entangled purposes, policy leaders often approach reform in a piecemeal way, advocating for their preferred forms of assessment and decrying the rest. But this too often involves mistaking the tool for the task. We might not like the SAT or ACT as a feature of college admissions, for instance, but abolishing those tests won't eliminate the underlying issue that spurred and sustained their use for almost a century, the need to rate and rank students who have been exposed to different teachers, curricula, and school environments. The challenge of comparison suggests the second reason why so little has changed, despite so much displeasure. We need assessments. How else would we determine which students are placed in honors courses? What would be the process for handling students who move from one district to another, or from one state to another? How would colleges select qualified applicants for admission? How would employers sift through applications from inexperienced recent graduates? How would families know how their children are doing? How would taxpayers know how the local schools are doing? There are lots of ways of answering those questions. But many of us aren't prepared to do so without assessment results, particularly the practices of grading, rating, and ranking. Part of the reason we need assessments is that they are a core element of the education system's infrastructure. It wasn't always this way. Over time, however, as academic success became important not only for further progress in school but also for job opportunities, we have asked our assessment technologies to take on more responsibilities for wider audiences. Today, they are incorporated into nearly every element of formal schooling, across both K-12 and higher education. Getting rid of them isn't as easy as replacing the computers in a media lab or the books in the library. It would require us to rethink almost every part of how we educate students. But if the balance is so askew and the complaints so perennial, why do we not demand radical change? Why is it that we wring our hands at the over-reliance on grades and test scores, yet accept them as the primary evidence of what young people know and can do? How can we take seriously the fact that student transcripts summarize an entire academic career, despite rarely being longer than a Twitter post? The answer to these questions is the third reason why we can't simply dump the practices of grading, rating, and ranking. We believe in them. Whether we recognize it or not, We cast our votes in favor of grading, rating, and ranking nearly every day. We expect our children to be quizzed and tested, to receive grades for their performance, and to be sorted into class ranks. We expect them to sit for exams that purport to rate their aptitude and achievement. And we expect them to carry permanent records not only across their schooling experiences, but also into their professional lives. Sure, we worry about their stress levels, stay up late helping them, and lament their disappointments. We grouse and grumble about cramming and grade-grubbing and the orientation toward tokens rather than learning. More often than not, though, we encourage them to play the game. That's because a real school, we collectively believe, gives letter grades, preps students for high-stakes tests, and maintains permanent records. Sure, there are some exotic alternatives that embrace divergent assessment practices, but they're the exceptions that prove the rule. And even in those cases, when students get ready to apply for college, they generally need to sit for standardized examinations and produce transcripts with letter grades. Assessment, like death and taxes, is a misery to be endured. Most of us believe this because we've never experienced anything different. Once upon a time, letter grades were introduced into our schools. Long ago, the first standardized test was given. And before any of us can remember, the transcript was born. Yet generations have passed since then. And because most adults spend more than a decade in the education system before sending their children to school, we develop particular views about what is normal. Expecting young people to have the same experience we did, we end up replicating the past, even as we complain about the present. Alternatives exist. In the United States and abroad, schools have developed different approaches to grading, rating, and ranking, many of which are familiar to us. Pass-fail grading, for instance, is something that many of us have experienced, as is the so-called narrative report card, which replaces or complements letter grades with a written account of student progress. But none of these, on its own, can hope to displace the existing approach to assessment that limits and constrains student learning. If any of these alternatives were sufficient, it would have changed the system by now. So, what can be done? If past efforts have failed so badly, what chance do future efforts have at success? This book is our attempt to respond to these questions. The answers we provide are informed by our research on the assessment of student learning. But they are also shaped by roughly 2 decades of work on the history and politics of school reform. This latter strand of scholarship, though less immediately relevant to the topic of the book, deeply informs our approach to the subject and our view of how educational change actually works. As a result, this book is built on 3 big ideas that shape our approach to this project, our analysis of the core issues, and our suggestions for reform. First, as historians, we begin from the premise that the tools we use to assess, record, and communicate about student learning were never obvious or preordained. Rather, we must understand them as the product of historical processes that reflect evolving beliefs and recurring conflicts about what schools should do, what students should learn, and what stakes should be attached to our desired outcomes. This historical approach is particularly useful for understanding how multiple layers of goals and functions have accumulated over time to produce our current practices. The implication of this observation is that if we want to understand our current set of practices, we need to start not with utopian ideas or high theory, but with a study of history. Second, having studied decades of persistent failure in school reform, we also approach this process with a keen appreciation for how deeply intertwined the elements of our education system are with other aspects of the system, as well as with the competing politics and ideologies of the wider society. More often than not, reforms fail not because of bad ideas, but because of a failure to account for complexity and the unintended consequences of change. Policy leaders all too often believe they can change a single element in the system without particular attention to everything that element is entangled with. In this respect, it can be useful to think of the education system as we would an ecosystem. The flora and fauna within an ecosystem evolved under certain conditions and in specific relationship to each other. Efforts to introduce a new species are certain to reverberate in a host of expected and unexpected ways. Recognizing the complexity of a system doesn't mean that we shouldn't work to create change. It does, however, mean that we must take great care in understanding the entire system. As historians and scholars, we believe prior failures to reform our assessment technologies have been chiefly a product of simplistic thinking. A truckload of slogans and gimmicks has produced very little change. To do better, we must pay more attention to what lies beneath the surface, and we must seek solutions that respond to the complex environments in which they will be applied. Third, and finally, schools are fundamentally conservative institutions. This observation is not a value judgment, but a fact. American reformers have never been short on radical ideas for reimagining schools. The reality, however, is that parents and teachers have been much less interested in trusting the well-being of young people to grand experiments. Change is hard because people prefer practices that, even when imperfect, have stood the test of time. And many of our assessment practices go back a long way. Our mentors, David Tyack and Larry Cuban, observed decades ago in their masterful treatise on school reform, Tinkering Toward Utopia, that teachers and administrators, when faced with a reform effort, tend to hybridize their practice, to take the best parts of the new and mix it with the old. This tendency to preserve existing practices and routines, even as we work toward reform, is part of the institutional conservatism of schools. We think reformers would be wise to remember this message about hybridization, which informs our thinking throughout the book. These ideas lead us to take a measured view of the prospects for reform. That might disappoint some listeners hoping to encounter a call for something more radical, but we don't think it forestalls meaningful change. Quite the opposite, actually. Recognizing the pragmatic conservatism of schools, we opt for a multi-pronged approach that invites concerned parents, educators, and leaders to consider their current practices, their degrees of freedom in crafting new policies, and the prevailing support for institutionalizing such work over time. The first step to securing meaningful reform, and a central focus of our book, is to develop a clear sense of how our system operates. Such an understanding needs to be focused not just on naming problems, but also on describing the how and the why of our approach to assessing and recording student learning. To do so, we must start from the premise that, regardless of how we feel about them, our present technologies actually accomplish something important. As we discuss later in the book, there are three core functions of assessment. Motivation. To produce particular responses and elicit specific behaviors from students, e.g., compliance. Communication. To transmit short-haul messages, e.g., from teacher to parents, and long-haul messages, e.g., from school to future employer. Synchronization. To promote system-level coherence and operation, e.g., proving that a student has completed one level of schooling and is ready for the next. To sustain learning in our schools, we can't just complain about grading, rating, and ranking. Instead, we need to replace those practices with something better. And in doing so, we need to recognize that any new practices will need to continue performing existing functions. Thus, while we theoretically support a more radical move like abolishing grades, we pragmatically lean more toward a solution that would serve as a reasonable substitute. Our idea is to de-weaponize grades by making them overwritable, that is, by embracing the idea that grades can and should be updated as students move toward mastery of a subject. It doesn't quite make for the same rallying cry as "no more grades." Imagine students chanting, "Go ahead and keep the grades, but make them less high stakes by allowing us to periodically alter them based on our improved skills." But unlike the drive to abolish grading, it might actually be adopted during our lifetimes. In short, we don't think that trying to assess student learning is the problem. Instead, we think the problem is that our present technologies are too clumsy for the work we want them to do. There are no silver bullets or panaceas, but there is much that we can accomplish if we are attuned to the core uses of grading, rating, and ranking, and to the root causes of our current problems with those practices. Our astute listeners will no doubt have noticed by this point that we have conspicuously avoided articulating a theory of learning. Where do we come down, a listener might wonder, on the question of how best to promote learning? After all, if we're making the claim that grades, ratings, and rankings have gotten in the way of learning, then we must have clear feelings about how students learn best. We could try to answer that question. We've both studied with experts on the topic. We've worked closely with educators and school leaders. We have read broadly. Ultimately, however, this is not a book designed for people who subscribe to a single theory or approach. In our view, current assessment practices impede real learning, regardless of what you think real learning looks like. Just as importantly, reformed assessment practices like those we describe later in the book are compatible with multiple theories of learning. We believe we can contribute most to this discussion not by weighing in on debates within the learning sciences, but by describing in detail the problems and challenges of grading, rating, and ranking. Our hope is that even if some listeners disagree with our prescriptions for change, they will still find the book useful for driving forward their own vision of learning. Even if listeners accept all of these premises of the book, they still might wonder why they should spend time hearing about a fairly niche topic like how we assess and record student learning. After all, the world is full of big problems that require our sustained attention. Even if we confine ourselves to the field of education, there are seemingly bigger problems than grades, tests, and transcripts. Segregation by race and class continue to worsen in the United States as our policymakers retreat from decades-old promises to make our schools inclusive. Inequitable funding ensures that the least advantaged all too often have the fewest resources. And, in an increasing number of states, wide-reaching voucher programs now threaten the very premise of public education. Why, then, should we spend any time worrying about grades, ratings, and rankings? The answer is that learning matters. We believe in the core principles of public education, that it should be democratically controlled, free of charge, and open to all. We also believe that our schools can and should be engines of racial and economic justice. But our schools must have learning at the center, especially if we wish for them to advance in the aim of equity. And we have serious concerns about the extent to which that can happen under the existing assessment regime. Grading, rating, and ranking distort learning in fundamental ways, beginning in early elementary school and carrying across secondary and post-secondary education. It's only because they do so in such a complete and thorough manner that most of us have become accustomed to it. Yet we can be shaken from our complacency. All it takes is a clearer picture of what an alternative might look like. So, what's the last citadel of learning in our system? Where is the process of education still at the center? Many elite private schools have worked hard to cultivate this image of themselves. But one needn't fork over five-figure tuition in order to see a classroom centered around inquiry, play, discovery, and joy. Such classrooms are located in every community across the United States and around the world. They're called kindergartens. As we were working on this project, we dropped in on a local school to watch 5- and 6-year-olds classifying insects. The classrooms bustled with activity. Young people were immersed in animated conversations, drawing pictures, explaining their work to teachers, and cheerfully engaging with their two guests. As students scurried about, we asked their teachers how they would evaluate student work on the project, and their answers surprised us. We knew that students wouldn't earn letter grades for the work or sit for an end-of-course standardized test. We knew they wouldn't have permanent records or class ranks. But what we hadn't anticipated was just how detailed and thoughtful the teachers' evaluation plans were. Of course, they were assessing student progress and offering feedback to their pupils. It shouldn't have surprised us at all. They just weren't using the technologies that have so thoroughly infiltrated higher levels of the system. Focused on student learning rather than on the demands of assessment technologies, Ms. Kennedy and Ms. Porter had created vibrant and engaging classrooms. Their students wanted to be there. In fact, at the end of the day, a few of them refused to leave, so busy were they on their insect projects. We left the school brimming with hope about what can happen in school. We then drove down the road to the local high school and talked with teachers there. What would it look like if the school got rid of grades, tests, and transcripts, we asked. And almost all of the teachers we talked to responded in the same way, by laughing at us. They wouldn't do the work, one of them said. Parents would freak out, another told us. Students want their grades, a third teacher responded. They want good grades, good scores, perfect records. That way, they can get into a good college. Students in the early grades aren't learning calculus or writing essays, it's true. But the academic work they are doing is every bit as ambitious and rich in rigor as it is in later grade levels. Young students are developing the ability to read and write, to reason mathematically, and to explain the world as scientists do. And yet, there is a major difference. Their intellectual work is often guided by the inherent value of learning, the drive to understand, the thrill of knowing, and the delight of getting better at something that feels like it matters. We found ourselves wishing that could be true at every grade level and in every classroom, all the way through college and graduate school. Now, it is important to note that kindergarten isn't always a refuge from the influence of grading, rating, and ranking. As recent research has found, accountability pressures have, in many cases, trickled down into the early grades. And the ultimate impact on teaching and learning, as one group of scholars found, is that many kindergarten teachers are devoting more time to advanced literacy and math content, teacher-directed instruction, and assessment, while spending substantially less time on art, music, science, and child-selected activities. But we still see a different approach to learning that inspires us, and that makes us wish that subsequent levels of schooling were similarly full of joy and meaning. We aren't suggesting that we have a simple fix, or that all of the world's classrooms should look like the kindergarten classrooms we visited. That would be a much shorter book, featuring much younger students. Instead, this book sets the stage for a more complex set of policy proposals that might actually work, an approach that might restore the balance required for real learning to occur in our elementary, secondary, and higher education systems. Building on a decade of research, this book explores the past, present, and future of how we measure student learning. Directed at a wide range of listeners, including parents, teachers, and school administrators, it offers a starting point for conversations about how and why we evaluate students, as well as for how we might do it better. Though the book looks particularly at the United States, it is not a narrow domestic treatise. Instead, it tells a surprisingly global story. As Chapter 6 makes clear, grading, rating, and ranking in the United States is not markedly different from what happens in the rest of the world. Details may change. A through F grading, for instance, might be A through E grading in other countries, or 1 through 10 grading, or 1 through 20. But the broad contours of the story are mostly the same. Because we anticipate a set of listeners with potentially distinct interests in our subject matter, we offer a quick word about the organization of the book to help listeners engage with it most effectively. This book is organized into three parts that explore, in turn, the present, past, and future of assessment. In part one, we begin with a look at our three chief technologies for assessing student learning: grades, chapter one, tests, chapter two, and transcripts, chapter three. We suspect that many pieces of the arguments we develop in these first three chapters will be familiar to our listeners. That our current grading systems, for instance, incentivize students to go through the motions rather than commit to learning. But we try to locate these complaints in the overall organization and structure of our education system. In describing and diagnosing our current practices and their many faults, we develop a foundation for thinking about what issues we need to address and why. Having developed this assessment in Part 1, you might suspect that Part 2 would be about solutions, how to fix the problems we've identified. But that would leave us without a crucially important perspective critical to getting it right in the future, a clear view of the past. In part two, then, we set out to answer the question we hear so frequently from exasperated parents: how did it get like this? Believe it or not, there was a time before grades and standardized examinations existed, a time when no records of student achievement were ever committed to paper. As we explore in Chapter 4, these practices developed over time and in response to very particular challenges. And in Chapter 5, we trace how these developments coalesced into our current culture of assessment. Recapturing this past reminds us that there was nothing natural or inevitable about our current practices. With past and present firmly in view, we can think about what assessment might look like in the future, if stakeholders are committed to change. Part 3 of the book opens with a look at the rest of the world. In Chapter 6, we examine the ways in which other countries face similar challenges. In Chapter 7, we turn back to the United States, looking at experimentation, large and small. Finally, in Chapter 8, we consider how the insights provided by the two prior chapters point the way forward to a future in which we do more to sustain learning inside our schools, colleges, and universities. We believe our suggestions reflect both the wisdom and humility that a clear understanding of our current system can impart. But we also hope that the arguments and ideas in this book will become the basis for concerned parents, educators, and system leaders to begin conversations in their own communities about the current state of assessment. It's long past time to tilt the balance back toward what matters most: learning. Part 1. Grading, rating, ranking. Undermining learning. 1. How grades fail. The most obvious problem with grading is the fact that it's so effective at motivating students. That may seem counterintuitive. How can success be a problem? Yet consider what, precisely, students are motivated to do when they strive for an A. It often doesn't have much to do with learning. Grades function as a kind of crutch in K-12 and higher education. Rather than instilling an intrinsic love of learning in students, our system, for the most part, motivates them extrinsically, with grades. As a result, students may learn something as they progress from kindergarten through higher education, but often only incidentally, in the pursuit of the rewards they're actually after. This isn't to say that students don't develop academic skills or that they never develop a real passion for the things they study. But, as any teacher who has been asked, "Is this going to be on the test?" can tell you, students' decisions about how they approach their schoolwork are strongly influenced by strategic considerations around grading. In the eyes of students, education often has value only because it can be traded for something else, namely, social and economic advantage. The badges and honors of school, students have been taught, will gain them access to good colleges, good jobs, and good lives. As a result, grades have become like scrip money or Disney dollars. They may not be legal tender, but they are certainly tokens of exchange, securing access to everything from gifted and talented programs to car insurance discounts. This may seem harmless enough, but the emphasis on grades rather than on learning undermines the inherent value of education. We may tell young people that we want them to develop a love of learning, and that school is a place where they can discover, develop, and realize their potential. Yet what we incentivize them to do is usually quite different. When students stay up late cramming for an exam, when they copy their friends' homework, and when they pester their teachers for higher marks, they are showing us the messages they've received. To be clear, getting good grades doesn't preclude students from developing a deep love of learning. Moreover, straight A students may learn some important skills and develop productive habits as they scramble to compile their perfect report cards. But the crucial point is that our system is set up in such a manner that learning may be incidental to most of what happens as young people progress through the education system. Here, one of our mentors, David Labery, is worth quoting at length. Students at all levels quickly come to the conclusion that what matters most is not the knowledge they learn in school, but the credentials they acquire there. Grades, credits, and degrees, these become the objects to be pursued. The end result is to reify the formal markers of education and displace the substantive content. Students learn to do what it takes to acquire the necessary credentials, a process that may involve learning some of the subject matter, at least whatever is likely to be on the next test, but also may not. The payoff for a particular credential is the same, no matter how it was acquired. So, it is rational behavior to try to strike a good bargain, to work at gaining a diploma, like a car, at a substantial discount. The reality of this situation is so deeply ingrained that even the smallest deviation under the most extraordinary circumstances produces backlash. Consider, for instance, the expression of dismay from Oregon parents when that state's Department of Education decided to suspend grading during the initial coronavirus outbreak of 2020. Many parents, no doubt, took the policy in stride. But signatories to an online petition were irate. Some wanted to know how to motivate their children without the brass ring of grades. As one mother complained, "How do I explain to my child that has great grades that she should keep working hard when anything that is D and above will still pass? This is ridiculous." Other parents were more concerned about the grades themselves. In short, they wanted their children to receive the tokens they were owed. As one parent commented on the petition, "GPA matters. Let students earn their grades and be rewarded." And as another parent noted, "My high school student has worked his butt off for his grades, and the wind was sucked right out of his sail." The upshot of this system is that for many students, school is simply the context in which they work to collect grades. In that sense, they aren't really students at all. They're employees. Their job descriptions are written on course syllabi and determined by the assignments that will be graded. Their pay, in turn, comes not in the form of a weekly paycheck, but in the form of quarterly grades. One student, making the case for assessment in the wake of the coronavirus pandemic, argued that letter grades provide compensation. And as one parent noted, "My daughter deserves the opportunity to receive grades to remain competitive with other high school students in other states and receive the appropriate accreditation for her hard work." In sum, grades motivate students, but they don't always motivate learning. Rational students, irrational outcomes. In pointing out that students are motivated to earn good grades irrespective of what they learn, we want to be clear that we are not blaming students or their parents for this behavior. Collectively, in the United States and around the globe, we have accepted a system that strongly incentivizes students to act strategically, to hustle their way to good grades by working smarter rather than harder. While some might argue that this is itself a useful life skill, we think most people would agree that such an outcome is not what school is all about. Consider the phenomenon of grade-grubbing, the practice of pestering instructors for higher marks, particularly on high-stakes assessments. Writing on the website of the academic journal Science, Adam Rubin reflected on his own experience as a grade-obsessed student. The grade was everything. The grade was the all-important, all-consuming, all-powerful proxy for my identity as a student. I wasn't about to let it slip through my fingers when I had a possible shot at a higher one. What did he do then when he received a grade lower than what he aspired to? He confronted the instructor and argued the hell out of that one point. From his perspective as an instructor, Rubin observed that his own students were no different than he was at their age. They begged, bargained with, and berated their instructor in pursuit of better grades. Not because they like points, but rather because the education system has told them that these points are the currency with which they can buy a successful future. Rubin was stunned by the fact that his students were simply responding as rational actors, operating intelligently within a system that rewards this kind of behavior. Grade-grubbing of the kind that Rubin describes may be relatively rare. Many students are likely to simply accept the grades they're given, even if they're dissatisfied. But the fact that grade-grubbing happens at all is evidence of the value that young people place on grades as the ultimate end product of education. Cheating is the most extreme manifestation of this attitude. Whatever it may indicate about students, it also shows us something powerful about the incentives created by grades. Consider, for instance, a study that sought to understand whether and why college students decided to cheat. As the authors of the study concluded, the most important reason why these students in our sample cheated was the desire to get ahead. To the surprise of the research team, that motivation was more important than variables like attitude towards cheating, opportunity to cheat, cultural or moral acceptance of cheating as an established norm, low risk of detection, or heavy time demands. As instructors at all levels know, it isn't just college students who are motivated to cheat. As another researcher studying the motivations of cheating put it, the problem of cheating starts early and increases as students move through school. As he found, grades played a central role. Many students told me they know cheating is wrong and they are not proud of their behavior. However, they feel they have to cheat to get the grades they need. Who cheats? Such questions are difficult to answer, given the powerful incentive for students to keep that information to themselves. Nevertheless, it seems that a majority of students find themselves operating outside of the rules at some point. According to one survey, 64% of students reported that they had cheated on a test. And as one researcher found, parents were often complicit, doing most of the work on important take-home assignments. Even the most morally upright students are often looking for the quickest way to earn the most points. For evidence, look no further than the persistent inquiry from students about whether a particular topic will be on a subsequent test. What they are saying, in essence, is that if they know what they'll be tested on, they can avoid wasting their time studying things that won't count. It's a classic shortcut that allows students to focus on what really matters, their grades. Unequal exchange. Schools are widely perceived as meritocratic institutions. That is, they are presumed to reward talent and hard work rather than inherited advantage. Yet the highest grades are all too often the reserve of a privileged minority of students. Why is that? One factor is parents. Aware of the uses to which grades can be put, middle and upper-class parents are a backstop against bad grades, and, as noted in the previous study, a quiet driver of grade inflation. As David Labery writes, it is elite parents that see the most to gain from the special distinctions offered by a stratified education system, and therefore they are the ones who play the game of academic one-upmanship most aggressively. Those least in need of academic support, in other words, are the most likely to be the squeaky wheels. Privileged parents will urge their children to reach out to teachers for help, will connect their children with tutoring, and will themselves intervene to ensure that grades never slip below the B range. The greatest inequities, however, may be a product of unconscious influence. As indicated by a large body of educational research, the strongest predictors of student achievement are family and neighborhood context. Teachers, of course, matter, but not as much as the out-of-school environment. To some extent, this is a direct function of resource inequality, of the difference between what can be purchased by higher-income earners and lower-income earners. But it seems that parental expectations matter more than family resources. That doesn't mean that affluent parents are better at raising children. Instead, they are more likely to exert pressure on students, in forms both subtle and overt, to succeed in school and bring home high marks. As research indicates, they do things like make regular inquiries about their children's marks and are likely to discuss the importance of grades for all manner of life outcomes. While grades can motivate some students to work harder in school, at least at particular kinds of tasks, they can also have a demotivating effect. Students with 4.0 grade point averages, GPAs, have a lot to lose. By contrast, their lower scoring peers, students who are often already systematically underserved, often see little to gain by exerting additional effort. If you're a C or D student, working harder seems like a bad bet. If learning is presented as work and grades are presented as pay, why would you labor for a reward that never arrives? Students from all backgrounds can be demotivated by grades. But, once more, it tends to play out in ways that exacerbate inequities. Young people from low-income families and historically marginalized.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.